It's like, we know, you don't even know who it is.
Well, it looks like they're still rolling in, but well, I want to say good evening. My name is Laura Longo. I'm the Special Events Manager here at Great Park in Hamilton County, and I am so honored to welcome you to our very first virtual Black History Month celebration. For those of you who aren't familiar with Great Parks, we're a group of individuals who are passionate about conservation, education, sustainability, and community. One of the things I personally enjoy most about my job here is that it gives me the opportunity to connect and build relationships with such a diverse group of organizations and individuals that share the same passions for sustainability. And that being said, I'm so excited to introduce you to our four inspiring speakers. So tonight we have Sarah Kent, Simone Bess, Brandon Reynolds, and Joy Sears. They're going to speak a little bit about the work that they're doing, the challenges they face, and what inspires them. I hope that you leave this as inspired as I am when I learn about what they're doing. And we will have a question and answer session at the very end once everybody's done. If you have any questions, feel free to just throw them in the chat. My colleague and I will monitor it and make sure that your questions get answered. If you'd rather do face-to-face, I can go ahead and turn the cameras back on once it comes to the Q&A session. And also, I have a resource page. So if you hear something about that you want more information about, whether it's the businesses or programs that our speakers are going to be talking about tonight, I will put that up on the screen so you can research and do some more research on that. So I'm going to go ahead and start with our first speaker of the evening is actually our very own Sarah Kent. Sarah is awesome. I'm a little biased, but I think Sarah is awesome. Sarah is our outreach manager for the Nature Center at the Summit, which is actually located in Roselawn. Sarah was recognized by the Wiz as one of Cincinnati's top 30 under 30. She's also the youngest Black woman manager here at Great Parks. And one of Sarah's probably most unusual and least talked about abilities is her ability to get people to try eating insects. She hasn't gotten me to try one yet, but I know it's coming. But enough about me. I know you guys didn't come here to listen to me talk, so I'm going to turn over the floor to Sarah.
All right. Hello. Like Laura said, I am the manager at Great Parks Nature Center at the Summit, and we opened back in 2019 in the summer. It was a little bit of a slow opening, just because we came into this building and this room, and it was completely empty. So we put in a lot of things that were either for the natural sciences or to practice like mindfulness. And we slowly were able to fill it and open it up to the public. So my dream for the center is for it to be a hub specifically for the community of Roselawn, which is in Cincinnati. For those of you who are not from Cincinnati, I see a lot of people from Orkyla here, so welcome. And we are basically trying to, right now with COVID, still trying to interact with the community, but it's a little bit of a smaller scale because we can't be open to the public necessarily with COVID going on. On our days that we were open, we would have about 40 kids at once, and then me and one other staff member with those 40 kids and just doing natural things with them, going through, we had like a star day, so we went into our like our stargazing class, and then we learned about just the different constellations and had all the lights off, and it was a way for them to just see the stars during the day. And we are just currently trying to plan for when we are open again. So planning days where we're going to be having people outside and doing summer camp with Miss Simone over here. So we will be having our nature portion of summer camp happening on Wednesdays doing field trips. And then we'll also be working with them, working with the kids once a week doing a nature activity to either interact with an animal or go hiking, just something to get kids outside, which is definitely one of my passions. So my goal is to always have people do something with nature, and it doesn't have to be big. It could just be walking outside and having that experience to interact with nature in a way that they haven't before. With a lot of people in the Black community and where I work in Roselawn, that is not something that they have an experience to do every day. They don't get the opportunity. So with Summit Center, it's a really great opportunity to have a green space and have the area provided for the community to interact with nature and like touch a snake or eat a bug or go and like even look at live giant birds that are right near the Mill Creek. So we're at a place that's located like pretty much in the city, but there's still nature there. And that's something that I'm really passionate about having them learn and connect with. And that's it.
Hey, Sarah, what got you started?
Oh, so I was always into bugs, and I feel like my parents are probably the ones to thank for that, because they never freaked out when I was like by myself hanging out with like spiders. I would go collect like their egg sacs and rip them open and just let the spiders crawl all over my hands. And no one was like, oh my gosh, Sarah, that's so weird. So I just kept doing that. And that led to me studying and focusing my research in college in entomology. And while I was in college, I was also paying for that by going to Colorado and working at a Boy Scout camp. So I was the nature director eventually at this Boy Scout camp. And it was one of those experiences where it seemed so fast because it was only for a couple months. It was just in the summer. But going out there and just kind of honing in on my teaching skills made me more passionate about teaching about entomology and just nature in general and having people experience nature. So just like putting in different like insect themes within our work was one of my favorite activities. We had this like thing called Cultures Run where they had to race across the like 5 miles of the camp. And they ended up, when they came to the nature center, they had to do a task, and their task was to eat mealworms. So that's probably where I started having other people eat bugs. But even like in seventh grade, which was the last 17 years, so this year is the year for all the cicadas from brood X to emerge, which is very exciting for me, and for a lot of other people, I'm sure. And I made a cicada rhubarb pie in seventh grade, and that was like the start of cooking for other people for bugs. And then I just kind of continued that. So after I worked at this Boy Scout camp, I ended up working for Cincinnati Parks. And I started a lot of their entomology programs and spoke at a lot of schools for that. And eventually I moved to Washington State and I was their gardener and also like an outdoor educator and ropes facilitator. So it kind of expanded into doing a whole bunch of different things from just like my main focus of entomology to like teaching people how to be comfortable getting on the zip line, which I'm afraid of heights, and that was really hard for me to do, but I had to do it for training. So and then after that, I ended up moving to Costa Rica and teaching about butterflies at a butterfly farm. And eventually I ended up moving back to Cincinnati, and now I'm working for parks. So this is my first job when I came back to the States.
So outside of COVID, what do you think is the biggest challenge you have working at the Nature Center?
I'd say because we're new, it's difficult to get people to come there. We only started with I had one neighborhood kid who came in and he's like, what are you doing? And I was just like, we're gonna unpack these real furs of these animals and kind of like display them. And he was so interested in the furs and that they actually came from animals. So the next day he brought a couple friends, and then it turned into having a larger group of kids coming every single week. Our rule is that if we're there and somebody wants to come in, they of course can come in as long as we're not doing the private program. So the challenge, COVID kind of stopped us from having as many people, right, coming in. So the challenging part was kind of stopping from where we were. I felt like we were going in a forward motion and getting more and more people involved. And then all of a sudden we had to stop and kind of regroup and figure out what programs would look like in the sense of the Nature Center, since it is a community-based center. So I'm still involved with the local community councils, and we're still working on the Roselawn Community Garden. We have a more of a focus on improving the outside as opposed to having people coming into the Nature Center. But just getting the word out to people that we're here is probably the biggest challenge right now.
Awesome. What age ranges are the kids that you serve these programs to?
Oh, all ages. So we have really little ones that come in. Since we're in the back of a church, I'm not sure if I mentioned that we are in the back of New Prospect Baptist Church. So there's a room that's right when you turn into the back parking lot. That's where the Nature Center is. And when they had church in person, there were a whole bunch of toddlers that came in. We've done everything from just a sensory program for little kids all the way up to adult team building with just different groups that want to form a bond that is nature related and kind of have that new experience too.
Awesome, Sarah. I think what you're doing over at Summit is incredible. And I can't wait to get the word out and get some more people over there for you. Thank you for taking time to talk to us about that. I think it's super exciting. And I think that kind of leads right into our next speaker. I don't know if I should do the intro or if I should let Sarah do the intro, because she, I believe, is your biggest fan, Simone. But our next speaker this evening is Simone Bess. And Simone actually runs a STEM-based summer camp that's going on its fifth year. Is that correct? Yep. Simone actually started in the corporate world of GE engineering before moving into STEM education, which is her passion. And Simone was actually also nominated for a Difference Maker Award for her work in improving children's lives in our community. I'm going to turn the floor over to Simone and let her talk about her STEM education.
It helps to unmute, right? So I've had a number of experiences with STEM education that probably date back to my coming to Cincinnati in the late 80s. And I actually got involved with an organization that doesn't exist anymore, but certainly some of the work continues. Minorities in math, science, and engineering. And as Sarah mentioned, I worked for GE when I first came here. So I have that corporate engineering, manufacturing background and experience. And when I left GE, one of the things that I did was work for this small organization, Minorities in Math, Science, and Engineering. And it was something that I absolutely positively loved to do. We did teacher training to help them understand. It wasn't called STEM back then, but it certainly had all of the components of our modern day STEM. So we did teacher training. We did programs for kids. I collected research in the areas of minorities in math, science, and engineering. So I left that organization, did a number of things, ended up teaching in engineering at Northern Kentucky University in another a program that doesn't exist anymore, an engineering technology program. And in that program, I taught one of the things I taught was an intro to technology class, but I also developed a piece for sustainability. So we're talking about the mid-90s. A lot of people aren't really talking about sustainability, but it was something that certainly spoke to me. So fast forward, I'm working at UC, and I have a joint appointment in engineering and education. And one of my tasks in engineering is outreach. And so I've been assigned to work on an outreach program that would be part of a GE grant, where GE was giving elementary and high schools and colleges 3D printers. And so I'm working on this grant, and I'm excited because we're gonna get to involve some K-12 students in this programming, per the dean's instructions. And so he kind of started the meeting off and gave his vision of the program and left out and left us to talk and design the program. And as people talked, I thought, well, they're not talking about outreach. I said, well, excuse me, when are we going to talk about the outreach piece? And they looked at me, and these are faculty and staff members at in the engineering department at UC, and they said, oh, we're not doing that. And I said, well, that was the instruction from the dean. And they said, yeah, we heard them, but we're not doing that. And so I was disgusted, but I left that meeting, went home, and wrote up a program for a STEM program for K-12 students, presented it to my pastor the very next day, and he said, we'll go look for some money and we'll do that. And so that is really how the STEM programs at New Prospect started. It just kind of, I'm like, oh no, well, they're not gonna do it, but I can do it. And I think that's pretty much who I've been most of my life, to know that we can do, if we put our minds to it, we can do, we can serve, we can build, we can create. And so I just remain excited in the many, many things that I've done in my life. I remain excited about the STEM programs at New Prospect. And it just so happens that sustainability has been the theme of our program since we started. And each year that piece for me grows and grows and grows. I just ran into an article out of Yes Magazine. And why it's significant to me is one of the things that I try to do is link famous Blacks in science or Blacks in STEM to get the kids to know who they are, to understand what they've done, you know, that whole history, so that they know that there are people who look like them who've done significant things in math, science, engineering, or the modern day STEM. And one of the people that we've done a Blacks in Science unit on is George Washington Carver. And this article that just came out this month, he says, I love to think of nature as unlimited broadcasting stations through which God speaks to us every day, every hour. And to me, how exciting would that be to get young kids who typically aren't connected with nature, connected with nature in that way, so that they understand their role in maintaining nature and get excited about it. So, I mean, that's a lot of what I do is just try to connect young people to things that make sense for them and help to encourage and motivate and inspire them to do more and be more. I'll stop talking.
So I think you were, when we were speaking yesterday, you were telling me about the opportunity to talk to an astronaut.
Yes. So I'm always looking for things and ways to connect kids with things bigger than themselves, right? So during the summer program last year, there was a program that was live from NASA where they were on at the space station. And so we turned that on and had the kids listen to it and we talked about it. And then this year I'm looking around at stuff and NASA puts out something that students can talk to. And let me not say this year, we've done an educational pod at the church since August. And so young people whose parents are working have an opportunity to drop their kids off. So not only are we helping them with their academic piece, but we're doing enrichment. Sarah's still there for us. And we started a little chemistry cooking class a couple weeks ago. So we try to enhance what they're getting in their various schools across the region. But I saw this thing for getting kids to talk to an astronaut. And I said, oh, that's cool, I'm gonna sign up. And then as I looked at the name of the astronaut, I'm like, I know her. How do I know that name? And so I looked up her bio and she actually went to high school with me. And so that was just like, wow, that was really special. So the kids enjoyed it. They got a chance. It was Joan Higginbotham. And it was only a half an hour program this past Thursday, but what a wonderful opportunity to talk to somebody that looks like you, who's actually been on a spaceship in space. Those are the kind of connections that I think keep kids excited about learning.
So what are some of the challenges you face with your STEM programs?
You know, I'm blessed to have the support of the church and the pastor. You know, from day one, he said, let's do this. So a lot of challenges that a lot of people have with space and those kinds of things, we don't have. We have a woman who volunteers her time to feed us, you know, and the kids every day. And so space is not an issue. We've been fortunate enough to find a little bit of funding to help to support us. I think the biggest challenge, even for COVID, is being able to expand to the point where we're offering what we do to other people.
And what age ranges of children participate in your activities?
Kindergarten through 12th grade.
Oh, wow.
So what we tend to do with the older kids is have them be peer supporters for us. So they get a little bit more responsibility. Even with the education pod, we have high school students, two seniors that come to the center. And I make sure that they do not only their academics, but they do some quote unquote community service by helping the younger people.
Wow. Can you tell us a little bit about, I know you talked about your focus with sustainability. Can you talk a little bit more about what that entails for the kids?
Yeah, so like I said, it's growing every year. But last year, I really made a focus to make sure that they really understood what sustainability was, what reduce, recycle, reuse, and refuse was. Every year we have what we call the genius hour. And in that genius hour, their task is to come up with a project, kind of like a science fair project that they work on over the summer, but it has to have a sustainability theme. And so they're presenting at the end of the summer, these wonderful projects that they've worked on for the duration of the summer that has a sustainability theme. So last year we had electric cars, we had creating gases out of human waste. We had a young lady who built a home that had a lot of solar and other features on it. So it just really varies across the gamut of sustainability. Of course, we work with plants, right? Sarah helps us with that. So they actually are weeding plants and growing plants. She talks to them about trying to think of map reading and compass reading was a part of what we did last year. The biggest bum out for me was that the kids didn't get to go overnight and have an overnight camping experience. But we're keeping our fingers crossed for this year. They created many biomes. They created worm compost. They took their footprint, and we talked about carbon footprint. They understood a little bit about what that was and how to reduce carbon, and how their families could even be a part of that. What were some of the other things that we did? Oh, of course, we created these little stone pots, and Sarah taught them how to make a fire. So we do lots and lots of things related to sustainability. And like I said, each year that'll grow. Last year, I got reconnected with a young lady who had been in a program that I did back in the early 90s, who had just finished her PhD in sustainability engineering. So local young girl, she grew up here, went to UC, and then got her master's and doctorate, I can't remember where. But her focus area was sustainability, and she actually had her PhD in sustainability engineering. So she actually created a video for us that talked about her journey to PhD and what sustainability meant to her and the kinds of things that she's been involved in her short professional life. So it was kind of neat.
That's awesome. Do you think that the education that you're providing to these kids, they're taking home and sharing with their family, and you think it's easier that we're introducing kids at an early age to these constant themes of green initiatives and sustainability?
We have to reach our younger people. We have to reach our young people because they are our biggest advertisers. They do take the information home. They do tell their mama, you shouldn't have put that in there. We need to have a recycling bin. Why don't we have a recycling bin? Or, you know, many, many things that they learn, they take home. We even do chess. And they love it. And they remember. So our program, summer program, ends in July for all practical purposes. And one of the mothers called me up last year and said, hey, my daughter is bugging me to make sure that a chess board is on her Christmas list. So they learn and they want to keep the learning going. And they share. You know, I think she was teaching the grandmother how to play chess. So it's pretty cool.
That's awesome. I think what you and Sarah are doing is amazing. And I think, you know, it gives me hope for the future that, you know, we are instilling these values in the children, right? And so they can push and lead that charge. So thank you.
Yeah, there's one question in the chat group that asked me how I was interested in STEM. And I grew up in Chicago, went to one of the first magnet high schools in Chicago. In addition to this astronaut who, Joan Higginbotham, was there. Your previous first lady was also in attendance during the years I was there at Whitney Ho. And I had a counselor who said to me, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I knew I loved teaching, and teaching was probably what I thought I wanted to do. But he said to me, you're good in math and you're good in science. You should be an engineer. And I said, an engineer? He said, yeah, go do some research and come back and we'll talk. And so that's really how I got interested in engineering. Even though at that time I had a older brother, Andre's 8 years older than me, who was, it's not 8 years older, maybe 5 years older than me, who was actually going to Howard University and studying civil engineering. So that's how my interest started.
Did you find it hard being a Black woman in the engineering field?
It was terribly hard. I think I've stopped having many of the nightmares from some of the experiences that I had at GE. But those experiences didn't just contain themselves at GE. There were challenges even at UC and some of the other places that I've worked as a professional. Even my undergrad experience, I went to Northwestern and I was struggling with a material science class. And I went to the professor to get some help and he kind of looked at me and he said, I don't know how to help you. I don't know how to tell you something that you might. And then he stopped and he said, oh, I know, I can explain it to you from a baking standpoint. And I looked at him and I said, you know what? I've never baked anything in my life at this point. So why don't you just try to tell me how you tell your other students? So the challenges have always been there.
Well, I think what you and Sarah are doing are spreading the word and making it seem attainable for anybody and hopefully paving the way for people to feel accepted no matter what segment they go into. So that's awesome. And thank you so much for taking time to talk about STEM. I know you that's your passion and you can tell when you start talking about it. Sarah did mention that you have a periodic table that you have posted. It looks like there's a lot of questions about that as well.
Christy, who's actually our head teacher in the program, actually found this and knew that I would absolutely fall in love with it. But it basically has the look of a periodic table. But as you get closer to it, you see that the letters represent African Americans in STEM and science and in math. And it's not for sale, but it probably is out there on Pinterest. I have to go and ask Christy exactly where she found it. I think it was on Pinterest, but we can certainly take a picture of it and send it to you, Laura. Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I think that's an awesome, that would be awesome. I'm sure a lot of people would love that. If I'm gonna go ahead and turn the floor over to Brandon, if that's all right with you, Simone. All right, well, let me tell you a little bit about Brandon. So Brandon started out in advertising before he apprenticing at the Carriage House Farms, where he developed an interest in beekeeping. In 2018, Brandon actually turned his passion into his own business called Be the Keeper. And Be the Keeper works with businesses and landowners to install pollinator habitats in urban areas. So I think it's amazing that Brandon's leading the charge to educate and reverse the decline of pollinators. But I'm not going to steal his thunder. I'm going to let him tell you about all of that. So.
Can everybody hear me? This is awesome. I was actually looking at the participants a little bit earlier and I think my mom is watching right now. So that's pretty cool. I need to call you afterwards because I think one of our cousins just told me that they're having twins. So I'll be calling you in like an hour anyway. So glad to see you're on the tube. I know we were originally supposed to start off and do some biographies, but then I'm listening to Sarah and Simone and I'm going to have to definitely plug in. And I'll give my story, you know, and then when all of you just wake all of you up when you go to sleep, I want to talk a little bit about the work the two of you are doing. But what's very funny and ironic, and I'll go into this towards the end as well, is that one of the people that actually inspired me to pursue my sustainability journey is actually on the panel. And I think that really ties, and I'm going to hype that up later on. And I think that really ties in, especially Simone, to some of your points about seeing people that have a similar, you know, background as you doing the work that you want to do. It's important, you know, and I think it makes it more tangible. So, you know, without further ado, just to really get into how I got into this, you know, I grew up just a normal guy, but I did go to St. X High School. And there, just to, you know, give you the punchline, the mission was men for and with others. And nobody really, I mean, you know, there were so many different lessons that we learned. You know, they also told us in the gymnasium, the first week of us being there, they gave us two words and they said, you have 4 years to figure out how they work together. And the two words were gift and story. And nobody, it was a conundrum. Nobody understood what that meant. But, you know, we were really armed to sort of, you know, when you say men for and with others, it's really not just about you and other groups of people. When you really dig into the meaning of it, it's like, okay, you're in this world, you're in this community, you're in this bubble, you're in Ohio. Or like Simone was saying, you're in this group that may or may not be closed-minded, but you have to think about how you relate to the bigger picture. And so when I think about when I got involved in sustainability, as all of us that are on this call know, it's not just about you and your journey on this planet. It's about how do you sort of, you know, drive this renewable energy so that we can create something that continues to be bountiful for longer periods of time. And so when I left St. X, you know, I finally figured out that gift and story is really, it's all that everybody has a gift and everyone has a story. And the more you tap into everyone's collective visions, you know, individual cultures, their, you know, who their, you know, their upbringing is, the more you can actually offer this sort of community to build each other up. And so when I got to UC, I had to choose a major. I just picked one that I saw on the list. I knew I wasn't going to make it in accounting. I knew I wasn't going to make it in what's another one? Finance. All the really businessy people call it finance, but I just call it finance. And the only one that made sense to me at the time was operations management. I didn't know what sales was, but that always reminded me of the weird people that just always ask you to buy stuff on the street. So I said, no sales. And so I chose operations management. And the way that it was explained to me in college was if just bear with me on this example. This is what they told me. This is what I remember still. They said, if there was a river coming down some land and there's a village along that riverbank and they can pull water from that easily, but there's this village all the way over here that they have to spend so much resources trying to get water back to camp. The operations manager would like put a rock here, divert the flow so that everybody could get water to camp. That's the way it was explained to me. So when I went into all my interviews, I said, I want to be that guy. I want to put that boulder out there. I want to divert that water. And all of my interviews, I still have the feedback sheets. Every single one of them said no. And they said, does not have the skills for OM, but would be terrific at marketing and sales. And I was like, I didn't realize that OM was more so, and Simone, you could talk about this because you probably work with operations managers at GE, but they're more so designing the processes that get the work done. And I don't think that that's where my brain was. I just wanted to move the boulder. And so when I look at the work that I'm doing with Be the Keeper, I love sales, and that's what really got me into advertising. But when I look at Be the Keeper, sure, when you look on Google, it'll say something along the lines of Be the Keeper works with businesses, municipalities, and residences and homeowners to plant pollinator habitats on their properties. But what that really means is, you know, if you think of a traditional building, you know, you got a building in the ground, people go there every day, and then it's surrounded by grass, which we as a society, and I'm not an enemy of grass, but we have somehow become comfortable with spending money on mowing, watering, fertilizing, reseeding, blowing the leaves off of it in the fall. And Sarah, you could probably know some weirdos out there that probably get some green food coloring and spray it on just to keep it a certain color. It's just, there's resources that we're dumping into just maintaining this ongoing aesthetic that doesn't really do anything for us outside of creating another extra thing for us to do at the end of the day. So, you know, I know we don't have all the time in the world, so I won't really go into what sort of got me into figuring out this landscape, this aha moment. But essentially, while I was, you know, at the advertising agency, you know, we were advertising for all these different, you know, brands like Cincinnati Bell, Cincinnati Insurance Companies, Caramel Mentos, True Mood Chocolate Milk, like all these big brands that people were using. But then I would go home and I look at the tube, I look at my phone, and you'd see all these negative media like bees are dying, you know, the Amazon is on fire. By 2050, millions and millions of people, you know, all this negative influence about, or all this negative news about how we were just doing the planet wrong. So when I left advertising and how I got into bees and how I'm going to go back to explaining why we plant these pollinator habitats, I knew that I had to find some way to advertise sustainability, you know, like we talk about sales, advertise sustainability so that people actually, you know, develop this more mindful understanding of the environment. So when we plant pollinator habitat at a property, I know I'm a beekeeper. I love it. It's my thing. It's my jam. It's my art. But the biggest thing is creating these pollinator habitats, you know, full of native perennial plants. You know, they, you know, if you put native perennial plants instead of grass on a campus, obviously, for all of you other plant geeks out there, you know that once they mature, you don't have to mow a pollinator habitat down. You don't have to micromanage it because it's native perennial plants that come back every year. So less resources, beauty, they look awesome. And three, for sustainability, for those companies, you know, it's way more interesting to say, hey, we are feeding hundreds of species of pollinators through our land. That's way more interesting than saying, we have LED lights. It just has such a deeper hit to your soul. And it's also cost efficient or cost effective for companies to make this investment in the land. And then as the pollinator habitat matures, they actually have, you know, spend less on maintenance because the pollinator habitat has really taken over that environment, and it's just providing value from there. So tying all this together, when I think about advertising, when I think about what Be the Keeper is doing, you know, yes, we want to create more safe spaces for pollinators, native bees, honeybees, butterflies, hummingbirds. I always say I got lucky at the fact that all these good different species share the same food source. I'm just getting you hype with my, you know, the art that I know with bees, that you understand, that you know, and then getting into your head so that we can plant more for everybody. And so to really tie this into what Sarah and Simone, and I know Joy's gonna go hard on this later, it's deeper than me just putting a beehive in the backyard of somebody's house. You know, it's deeper than even the pollinator habitat that we might put in the back of a really big, or the front of a really big business. The biggest thing, and this is what all the people on the panel here and I share, is transforming someone's mind from being like unaware, like, hey, I don't know where to start, to, hey, I can do this. I can be sustainable. I can care for the environment. And I think too often, you know, even with society, it's like you really see somebody at nothing, and then you see them at like, you know, doing, you know, super, super well for themselves. It's like, okay, I've never shot a basketball before, and then LeBron James. The journey to get here is super intimidating. It's like going from 0 to 60. It's too hard to really fathom how to even get started. And so oftentimes we stay put. But the biggest thing is, you know, maybe you just get that, you know, one, you know, you go from level 1 to 6, 6 to 12, you know, these smaller steps, like what Sarah's doing with Simone at New Prospect Baptist Church. You know, hey, learn how to read a compass, go out and start taking walks, and then maybe you'll learn about all of the native plants in your backyard. And so really what we do at Be the Keepers, we're trying to get in people's heads so that they can make that nature investment. So hopefully that all made sense. If you want to learn more, I know we're chatting right now. I really want to talk about a few things about Simone and Sarah and Joy for the next 2 minutes before I get kicked off here. One thing that Simone, I'll let you get into this later. You said, and I wrote this down in very big, bold font in my notebook. You said nature is a living being, you know, it's like this community. And I really, you know, vibe with that, because when I think about Joy, who's somewhere, I can't see your picture right now, but I know you're here. This might've been 3 or 4 years ago. I get a phone call from the guy who helped me get into college. And he's like, hey, there's this lady that's, you know, one of my friends, she's doing this green pop-up shop. I think it was in this place called the Globe. Joy, you can confirm, it's like the Globe building by Finley Market, People's Liberty, and she's doing a zero waste pop-up shop. And so that got me, you know, really tweaked my brain and got me doing a bunch of research, because at that time, the only people I know doing zero waste were, you know, brunette, you know, some girl named Charlotte living in Brooklyn that plays ukulele. You know, I never saw somebody in my own community that's powering this zero waste movement. So that really inspired me as I'm thinking about, okay, you know, Be the Keeper, getting people to care about bees. It's like, oh, I can do this. This is a thing. So Simone, really awesome point about how, you know, you have to see, you know, other people with similar background just to give you the rocket fuel to keep going. Because it's hard when you think like, is this even really the industry for me, or should I just do what I know, which is what I've seen? And then even Sarah, so Joy, love you, can't wait for you to talk. And Simone, love you too. Sarah, my last thing is, you talk about, you know, people eating, you know, bugs and everything. You know, I've done it a few times. But the biggest thing is that, you know, you talk about pushing past the blocks. Like, I thought composting was weird back in the day. Like, what do you mean you're taking your bananas and granola bars and Kroger bags and turning them, and all of a sudden it's turned into stuff for your garden? Like, that was weird for me until 2017 when I started taking classes at the Civic Garden Center. But once you push past that block, now I can't even think about having food waste. Now I'm like, how can I compost my bones and my dairy? So it's just all to go through, all this to, you know, all to say is the things that the four of us share is that we know that we have to do this work, because if it's not for the four of us, I don't think any of us want to see what would happen if, like we say, the younger generation wasn't able to be inspired. So I'm really happy to be here. I'm a little overhyped for this conversation, but it's going to be a good one. So thanks for having me.
Hey, thanks, Brandon. I love how hyped you are. I think your passion shines through, and that's awesome. Can you talk a little bit about the state of pollinators? Like, you know, what pushes you to do this? Like the changes that we're hoping to see, things like that?
Yeah, what really gets me jazzed about pollinators is how they tie into biodiversity. It's, you know, I know you hear a lot about, you know, pollinators, they create food for humans, like, you know, 1/3 of every bite for, you know, is due to pollinators. And that's very, very valid. That is very, very valid. But for me, that's still like, oh, that's so human centric. Like, oh, we need the pollinators for us, right? But what if we need the pollinators for the biodiversity that keeps the community that we talked about before, the community of nature, together? You know, that's really what I'm thinking about. You know, I mean, I'm not saying I don't want us to have food. We need food. But at the end of the day, you know, I don't want to live on Mars, right? Unless it's, you know, terraformed and all that. But I don't want to live on a barren, you know, planet. And so what really excites me about pollinators is how they really tie into this system. You know, they've been evolved for hundreds of thousands of years to have this co-evolved relationship with plants. And so, you know, just by, you know, working with the pollinators, increasing the amount of food that they've got available, and so they can keep their population stable, we're actually giving ourselves insurance to keep going. So as far as the state of pollinators, I think that there's obviously, you know, huge, huge decline. You know, I was even talking to somebody the other day about lightning bugs and how as kids, we used to catch them in a jar. We used to live in College Hill, and we used to catch them in a jar and kind of walk around, you know, like you were in a Harry Potter movie with fireflies in your glass. But now, you know, I don't even remember. I mean, I guess it's been quarantine, so I was always indoors, but it's been a while since I've seen a bunch of lightning bugs. So when I think about the state of, you know, pollinators, it's on the decline. And all of you know that as well, because when you drive, I always say when you drive, everybody here has probably driven to Columbus, right? And you know, you drive past that sign, it's like, you know, where would you like to spend eternity, right? And around that, there's just a bunch of, you know, farmland. And, you know, if you think about a lot of our businesses, a lot of our urban spaces, you know, you don't really see pollinator habitat that's providing food for these species. So until we start planting more, consuming less, I think the pollinators are going to have a hard time. But I think that there's light at the end of the tunnel. And if we keep working hard, you know, I think, you know, by 2050, the news will be totally different. By 2050, you'll be hearing stories about how humans, you know, reshaped or flipped pollinator decline on its head.
Do you have any tips or maybe advice for people who don't know where to begin, are looking, you know, for their backyards or things like that?
Oh, for sure. I'll actually send you to two organizations. I think I just saw somebody that's on the board. I can only see Zuri C, but Zuri, I believe, you can correct me in the chat if I'm wrong, but I think you're on the board of Adventure Crew. And I've been volunteering with Adventure Crew for like 3 or 4 years, maybe 5. And they're all about getting high school students, you know, I mean, we just did something with Hughes, I think Gamble, you know, so many Walnut Hills, there's so many high schools. Oh, said, yep. So nice to see you, Zuri. You know, they take high school students out to do out in the nature, do whether it's rock climbing, biking, hikes through the woods, just getting them really exposed to nature. So I say, if you have any students or kids, know of anybody with kids, connect to organizations with students that are in high school, plug them in an adventure crew, because not only do they get to learn about nature, not only do they get to have fun in nature, they get to learn about it. And number two, I would plug people. Like I got involved. I was lucky to take a composting class at the Civic Garden Center in 2017. And through that got me connected to zero waste. I started finding out about people like Joy. Then I started apprenticing at Carriage House Farm to learn bees. And then it just sort of populated my head with all these green alternatives to what my life was at the time. So I would say plug into the Civic Garden Center. They make their living teaching people how to be green, just like Sarah does. And so I think if you really tap into those two organizations, you'll learn a lot about pollinators and what they do in the environment. And you could also follow us. I mostly use Instagram. I'm trying to learn how to use LinkedIn. Apparently that's like the adult social platform for professionals. But we're on Instagram at @bthekeeper, the letter B, the keeper, and you could follow our adventures on there.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing with us, Brandon. That's awesome. So I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Joy, who's our final speaker this evening. I'm going to give just a few talking points. There's way too many to cover them all. But Joy is a creative strategist, college professor, and social entrepreneur. She was actually one of 20 social entrepreneurs from around the world who was offered a prestigious fellowship to design sustainable packaging with H&M in Germany. She was also the recipient of the People's Liberty Globe Grant, which she used to launch the Green Store, which is the sustainable pop-up shop located in Over the Rhine that Brandon was discussing. So I'm going to turn the floor over to Joy.
Good evening, everyone. I hope you can see me and hear me. I had a great spot on the roof of my building, City Club downtown, and this group of like 20 teenagers walked in like with beers and music. So I was like, oh my God, I have to find another place. So I'm in the restaurant. I have your energy, Brandon. I match your energy, but I'll try to keep it contained here in the restaurant. But let me know if you can't hear me. So I actually, I'm like a visual kind of person. So I put together some slides that I would like to share. Laura, do you think you could let me? When I got disconnected, I wasn't able to get back in. So it's saying I need to get permission to screen share.
Well, let me go ahead and fix that for you.
But yeah, while we are getting that together. My name is Joy. So I teach full-time or had been teaching full-time at Miami University. So I'm a college professor there where I teach creativity, design thinking, and social innovation. So that's my background. I consider myself a serial social entrepreneur. So I'm constantly starting businesses that make the world better in some way. And I'm a little ADHD, so I'm always trying to do something new and different and innovative. But I like to say, I know it sounds super corny, but like I was actually born with a hole in my heart. And I say that, although it's true, you know, it is a little corny, but it was big enough to do major damage, but somehow big enough for the entire world to fall in. So I've constantly, my parents have instilled in me this idea of trying to make the world better, leaving the world better than how I found it. And so that is really what fuels the work that I do. So my journey into sustainability, although I was constantly trying to think about how can I make the world better, originally started in the arts. I'm from Cincinnati. I moved to New York right after high school. I went to Walnut Hills High School. I don't know if there are any other alum on the call. So studied art and social change, creativity at NYU. I had a friend invite me to South by Southwest Eco. So as some of you may know, South by Southwest is this huge like music film festival in Austin, Texas. Years back, they did a eco version. And there was this, the keynote speaker was Ron Finley here on the left, who's known as the Gangsta Gardener. So if you've not checked out his TED Talk, I totally recommend it. And he got on stage and really and proceeded to blow my mind. Like, it was the best talk I've ever heard. So Ron Finley, if you don't know, really great TED Talk is Plants Gardens out in South Central LA. So he was talking about his journey into sustainability in a historically Black neighborhood in Los Angeles. And I was just really kind of sucked in by his energy and by his story. And I was like, I really want to learn more about sustainability. And there was also a talk by Amber Valletta here on the right, who is an actress who has her own sustainable fashion line. And this was the first time I'd heard of sustainable fashion. I was like, I've been always really interested in fashion. Of course, interested in the environment, making the world better. This was the first time where I heard that there was a whole industry where people were combining fashion with the environment. And I was like, I absolutely want to do something with this. So some of the things that I took away from that talk by Ron Finley and some of the others who were talking at South by Southwest Eco was this idea that the green movement must be uplifting, empowering, engaging, honest, and real. So it must be polished and tell the story in a way that people will understand. So after that first year at South by Southwest Eco, I met up with a few other friends and we realized that there was not a lot of diversity at South by Southwest Eco in Austin, Texas. So I couldn't find anyone that looked like me outside of Ron Finley, who was speaking. So we actually went back the following year with a panel of all young Black people talking about growing the next generation of green leaders. So it started from seeing someone like Brandon mentioned, who looks like me in this sustainability movement, and then being able to go back the next year with a panel of our own and present. And I thought that was a pretty cool, interesting trajectory. So after that, I actually started, my first green project was called Green is the New Gangsta. So it was taking this idea of like, how can we make sustainability cool, hip, fun, interesting. So I actually pitched this idea and won what is called the World Summit Youth Award. So I was flown to Brazil. And it was all about young people who are using technology to advance the United Nations Millennium Development Goals, which are now the Sustainable Development Goals. So that first project is actually the early iteration of what I'm working on now, which is that Green Life. So a digital platform that equips people with sustainability solutions, especially young urban communities. So from there, I continued to learn and grow and work in sustainability. So I applied to be one of, I was one of 20 social entrepreneurs invited to Hamburg, Germany to spend a few months working with H&M Germany to design sustainable packaging for one of their product lines. So I worked in mostly creative and branding on this project and pitching. So it was really cool to go through kind of a design thinking process to develop packaging for a huge corporation like H&M, and to see how corporations are trying to make some headway, although not all of them are incredibly successful, H&M being one of them, but how they're trying to be more sustainable and more eco-conscious with the things that they're producing. So that was back, I want to say maybe 2015 or so. After that, I worked as a journalist for a while. I wrote for different publications talking about sustainability, specifically as it relates to corporate social responsibility. So again, thinking about the way that these larger corporations are trying to make headway when it comes to sustainability. And then that led me years and years later to create the Green Store. So after I lived in New York, I lived in New York about 10 years. I ended up moving to Amsterdam, where I lived for about 3 years before coming back here to Cincinnati. So when I came back, I really wanted to do something for the community. So I applied for a grant with People's Liberty. So that's the pop-up that Brandon mentioned. So I was given a grant to use the Globe space at People's Liberty, which is right across the street from Findlay Market. And I did a summer pop-up shop, which was focused on sustainability and specifically sustainable fashion and lifestyle. So I worked with Urban Blooms, which I'm sure some of you know make the beautiful living walls and living spaces around the city. So we were able to get some green graffiti in there and do a living wall and create a space, not only a place for people to come and buy sustainable products. That was actually not that big of a goal for this project. The goal was more so creating a space to start a conversation about sustainability here in Cincinnati, to invite people who are familiar with sustainability and some who aren't, who have never heard of sustainability, to learn what it is, what kinds of products are sustainable. We did a lot of events in the space. We did yoga, we did gardening, wellness workshops, recycling 101 workshops, just creating a space for people to learn and grow and have a conversation around sustainability here in Cincinnati. And so what I found from that project, and of course, you know, working with even before that project, is this idea that the zero waste movement is not necessarily accessible, affordable, or inclusive to people like me. That's what I heard when people would come into the store. I've never seen a person of color working in sustainability. I like to make the joke, you know, a lot of people, when they think about sustainable fashion specifically, it's like granola eating hipsters and people that wear like socks with Birkenstocks and hemp dresses. And it's just, it's not cool. It's not fun. I don't see myself in those movements. And so I really wanted to address that. And that's kind of the sentiment that fuels the work that I'm doing now. I also know and am driven by this idea that Black people specifically are underrepresented in the sustainability movement, yet we're more likely to be negatively impacted by climate change. And I just thought that that is really interesting. Every day I'm learning about more people around the world, more communities of color that are working in sustainability and doing the work, but we're not the ones that are the face of the movement. So that's something that I want to think about and change, because we are sustainable and we have great ideas and great things that we're working on. It's just that we're not always given those platforms to talk about it. So the project that I'm working on and how the Green Store has evolved, although I am still very much interested in brick and mortar and having that physical space for people to come inside and learn more about sustainability, of course, with COVID and life, I wanted to think about how those experiences could be translated digitally. So the Green Store will live online as that green.life. So it's less about here's a place to come and buy products, because I know I have a conflicted relationship with capitalism, like having a, like you have to buy this thing to be considered sustainable. I want to get away from that and make it more so about here's a place where you can come and you can learn more about sustainability through the digital platform. So of course we sell products, zero waste products, like other stores. I envision that Green Life and the Green Store in the near future focusing or featuring a lot of products by specifically Black women and women of color that are creating sustainable products around the world. So it will be a place where you can come and buy anything, any of the tools that you feel that you need to live a green life, but then you're also getting the education and the community and the resources to be able to do that as well. So I recently received a $20,000 grant from the United Way of Cincinnati to fuel that green life and the green store. And one of the projects that came out of it is called the Mamapreneur Program. So I'm a new mom myself. I just had a newborn 3-4 weeks ago. And then I also have a toddler who is almost 2, and saw that, you know, there are a lot of women, especially Black women here locally, have great ideas for great products that may not necessarily be sustainable, but they could be. So I created the Mamapreneur Program to target these local moms to be able to create a business that could sustain themselves and their families by producing products in a sustainable way. So we go through the process of launching a business and creating a sustainable product from idea to implementation. And then the idea is that those products could eventually be sold through the green store as well. So I really love the idea of nurturing, you know, I'm an entrepreneur and growing as an entrepreneur myself, but how can I encourage and inspire other women and other entrepreneurs to create and launch their own businesses as well? So that's something that I'm working on right now. So yeah, with that, I have a little challenge for the people here today, and with some working with the funding that I got from United Way, I'm like, I want to do something where I have something to give away for free. So I'd love if there's anyone on the call who has, I know the past, we're going into almost a year of being on lockdown. A lot of us have been in our houses for a long time, just to spread some inspiration around how are other people surviving the pandemic? How are you maintaining? I feel like I'm a lot less green with kids, and then with also being stuck in the house, I don't feel like I have the same sustainable habits. So if you are maintaining your sustainable habits, or you're surviving the pandemic and pulling through in some way, make a post on Instagram and tag me, and I'm actually going to be giving away some of our COVID kits here. So we have this, I found these plastic-free face shields, so they're actually made out of tree resin. We have some sustainable hand sanitizer and these little this keychain that you can use so that you don't have to touch things. So I'd love to give a few of those kits away. So yeah, that's a little challenge for the people on the call. If you have something inspiring to share about how you're pushing through in the pandemic, tag me in your post on Instagram and I'll send you one of these kits for free if you'd like. So yeah, that's basically a little bit about my journey. I'm still on the journey. I don't know that I have an answer for how to get people excited and engaged about sustainability, but of course that's like the question that's fueling the work that I do. So if you would like to connect with me or learn more about the Green Store, my two handles are here, thatgreen.life on Instagram, and we're also on Facebook, and then @forfreepeople is my personal handle. So I'd love to talk with you and learn more about what you're doing as well. I'm really inspired by the work that, you know, the three others that are on the call here today, and others who are here locally doing really great work when it comes to sustainability. So I'd love to connect with you.
Hey, Joy, in your experience working with large corporations, do you think that it's being driven by a genuine desire to want to change, or do you think it's being driven by consumers wanting that change and demanding that?
I definitely think it's consumer driven. Of course, like even when I think about H&M and talk about H&M, we have this idea across of greenwashing across the board. So I find that a lot of corporations know that consumers want more sustainable products, and they are more likely to say like, hey, my t-shirt is sustainable, and then you look at it and there's maybe 5% organic cotton and 95% polyester, which is plastic. So I find that a lot of people are talking the talk and not necessarily walking the walk. From a corporation standpoint, I do think there are some that really genuinely realize the impact that they have on the environment and want to do something different, want to do something, they want to be better. But I definitely think that it is driven by consumers. There's a lot of movements popping up, like the Fashion Revolution is one, which happens. They do this Fashion Revolution Day in April, where it encourages everyone to ask the question, who made your clothes, and turn your clothes on inside out so you can see the tag and see where your clothes are made. And movements like that, where consumers are going to these brands and directly asking them, like, where are my clothes made? Who's making them? What are they made out of? And supporting that movement, I think that's only going to increase in the future. So to see if it's genuine or not, it's kind of hard to say, but I do think that consumers are the ones that are making the push happen and demanding better from these brands.
I think that's important to know that, you know, we do have power with how we spend our money, right? And how we devote our time. That's key.
I like to think that each dollar is placing a vote for the world you want to see. So every choice that we make is making a vote, placing a vote for the kind of lives that we want to live. So I think it's really about being intentional across the board and thinking about, like, what is the impact that I personally have on the world around me, and how can I try in my own little way to leave the planet a little bit better than how I found it.
So do you have any tips as far as sustainable fashion, any guides for people who just genuinely don't know and don't know where to start?
Yeah. So I think, and I was on a panel, a zero waste panel, probably a few months ago, and we were kind of talking about this zero waste movement kind of has a level of privilege with it. A lot of the kind of zero waste products cost, they're more expensive, and people feel like, I don't have a lot of money to go out, throw everything I own and start buying, you know, bamboo toilet paper or this or that. And the same thing with fashion. So a lot of people think like, I have to go and spend $100 on a t-shirt for some obscure sustainable fashion brand to be considered sustainable, and that's just not the case. There's so many ways that you can buy or wear sustainable fashion without spending a lot of money, wearing vintage clothing, upcycling clothing, wearing the clothing that you currently have for a longer period of time, thinking about the materials that you buy. So if I'm like, I personally I don't buy new things. I haven't bought many new things recently, but if I am and I'm forced to search on Amazon or, you know, go to some store, I'm looking at the materials and just really trying to avoid any plastic materials like polyester. So even if you just say, I'm going to cut out polyester and I'm going to wear cotton instead, or especially organic cotton or something like that. I think it's making small choices over time and not feeling like I have to throw everything that I own away and go out and buy some whole new wardrobe, which again is like a potato sack in many cases in terms of fashion. So I would just say start small, and there are lots of websites and platforms, and eventually that green life will evolve into one. I didn't mention, but through the Green Store, I've developed my own sustainable fashion line. It's called Amsterdamage. So within the next few months, and I sold Amsterdamage through the Green Store pop-ups, but that will be getting, I will be putting that online in the next few months. And that's really like a seed to skin brand where from the moment the I use materials like recycled plastic bottles, eucalyptus, organic cotton, non-traditional materials in creating like things that people can wear every day and they're comfortable. But there are lots and lots of others. So I think it's just maybe doing a little bit of searching online into sustainable fashion. What are some of those brands and supporting those brands? But then just thinking, you know, one piece at a time. And even if it is a piece that isn't made out of eucalyptus or recycled plastic or something like that, but investing in pieces where you think about having them in your life long term. So that's the mindset that sustainable fashion is really working against fast fashion, where you go to some place like H&M and buy a t-shirt for $5 because you have some place to go or you want something new. But you're thinking like temporary satisfaction. If I'm going to buy any item, I'm going to think about like, could my granddaughter wear this pair of shoes 40, 50 years in the future? And if the answer is no, I'm not going to buy it. A lot of the clothing that I wear actually comes from my mom and both of my grandmas. So having fashion that you can pass down to your children and have pieces that represent you and your personality and your sense of style, I think is the most important thing. So I think just making those small individual changes with each piece, even I'm going to put something on my list and wait a month. And if I still like this thing, then I'll buy it. But getting rid of that emotional satisfaction of just buying a bunch of things, especially because we're all sitting in the house, there's not a whole lot more to do. But if you can kind of change your mindset in small ways over time and think about how can I use what I already have or use what already exists in by going like vintage shopping or something like that, that would be the best way.
Awesome. You know, I think it's interesting after all of you have kind of echoed the same sentiment that it's small changes, right? We're not trying to just throw everything out to the wall at once, right? You know, small steps. And I think it's so important that, you know, when we're sharing these messages that we communicate that, right? We're not trying to change your entire life, you know, or like flip it upside down, but it's small scale changes, you know? And once you start, it's like, it almost becomes like, oh, okay, that wasn't as bad as I thought. Like, what can I do now, right? And then all of a sudden you're like, oh, okay, well, what about this? And then you start to see these things that you didn't even think about before, right? Like, and I think it's, you know, sometimes we take for granted the power that we do have with the money that we spend, the actions that we do, you know, the way that we share what we're doing, because there are so many people here locally who are doing amazing things, but we don't always, I think just people in general aren't very good about bragging about what they're doing, right? Because you're doing it, that's what you do, right? And so I think it's really important that you guys are spreading this message, and that, you know, you are reaching out to so many different people that it's just incredible. I think, you know, in order to have global change, we need to start small and start locally. And I honestly can say that it's so inspiring hearing all of you talk. I'm so glad that you guys got to share what you were doing. We have a few questions that we didn't get to cover through the chat. If you guys have a few moments still, I'd love to put them out there. All right. So Brandon, we had one for you regarding actually the lawn. So have you had any struggles with ordinances that may have standards for lawns?
I haven't had any troubles yet. I think that'll be I've heard that HOA, I've never been in an HOA before. I've only lived in, houses or apartments. I live in like normal conditions. You know, I'm just like, I'm still a young guy. So I'm not really like high class enough to have an HOA, but I heard HOAs get kind of crazy. So, I'm envisioning that one day I'm probably going to get a client that lives in an HOA. And actually I have heard that there are some HOAs out there that say, we don't want any dandelions or any clover. We just want grass. So I think that that's probably going to come when I have an eventual client that lives in an HOA or an HOA as a client, but I haven't had it yet. Fingers crossed. But there is a part of me that is a bit scared of the HOA.
Well, hopefully we can just convince the HOAs that lawns aren't as beautiful as they thought they were, you know?
Yeah.
Sarah, we actually have somebody who wants to know if you're going to put together an insect cookbook.
Maybe someday. I have a book of recipes that I have written down for different things. And I'm trying to perfect certain recipes because I am picky when it comes to eating insects specifically. So that will be, it'll be great because I will have a ginormous surplus of cicadas in a couple months that I'm just going to stuff into bags and freeze them so I can just experiment all through the summer. And I will report back with my favorite recipes, but we're also going to have like a cooking show on our Facebook Lives for Great Parks. So stay tuned.
Speaking of that, what types of bugs do you eat? Like, or are edible?
I like to, okay, if you're in a survival situation, I always look at it like anything that is like earth colors, so like brown, green, sometimes yellow, those are safe to eat. And then, or white, because usually if it's white, it's like a larva, and you can definitely eat like lots of larvas, everything from like bees to beetles. And honestly, larvae are great if you're trying to have like a really protein-packed, juicy snack. So think of like caterpillars and like mealworms, which like I grow mealworms at the Nature Center. So there's an active colony there. But if you're in the wild, even like a wild bee larva, sorry, Brandon, but you can go into like a log and dig that up and like a rotting log and get any type of larva out of there. And any aquatic species are also edible. Please like consult with me before you eat bugs.
Can I validate something that Sarah said real quick?
Yes.
Yes, the bee larvae have all the good stuff in them. I'm actually reading a book about, apparently we had way more varied diets back in the day, and eating insects was a huge thing. And I had, I have had pancakes cooked with cricket powder. I've had granola bars or fruit and granola bars. There's all these bars that they cook with crickets. And even in some countries, they're a delicacy. And even you can confirm this. I don't know if this is true, but aren't shrimps basically like the insects of the sea?
Yeah. Yeah. They're both.
So it's like, it's funny. So yeah. We just sort of like pick and choose our insects, but it's like, I wonder, like, maybe it's not as weird as, TV tells you.
How different is eating bugs than eating sushi, right? So sushi used to be a taboo in the Western world. Insects are a taboo, but we're getting there, and it could be part of your everyday diet if you want to try it out.
It looks like we have a question for all of our panelists. Was there a specific defining moment where you know you inspired someone else? And if so, what was it?
So I know the young lady that I talked about coming and doing, well, doing a YouTube video for us, the new PhD in sustainability engineering, came to one of my summer programs as a seventh or eighth grader. And up until that point, she had no interest in engineering at all. And so when I talked to her mom to congratulate her and her daughter on her new PhD, she said, it started back with your camp. You changed her path. And so that just is a wonderful feeling. And there are, I'm sure, many, many more stories, but that's one of the recent ones.
I'll go. More recently, I've had a lot of like aha moments of, oh, like nature isn't as scary, or, oh, I can experience this like in a safe way. My, probably one of my favorite ones, like at Summit Center, was this kid who was just deathly afraid of snakes, like didn't want to walk onto the side of the room where the snake was, even though the snake was in it, like in its enclosure. All of our ambassador animals can't like escape. We don't let them run around the nature center just because they can. So we worked with him week by week, because he would come in every Sunday, and it went from him not going into the side of the room where the animals are, all the way to the point of holding it eventually after a month. And once he was able to interact with the snake and realize that the snake wasn't going to eat his head off, as he liked to say, it was just an amazing experience, because then after that, he came in every week and was just like, Miss Sarah, can I hold the snake? Can I touch the snake? Can you bring the snake out? And it was just amazing. He even did like a report for school on snakes specifically. And I don't think that would have happened without him just having the experience of realizing that this could be something that was safe for him to experience.
Yeah, I got a quick one. Like, I'm sure, Enjoy, you can't say this guy right here on the panel, I got him. But you know, we all inspire a lot of people, and I'm even inspired by a lot of your work. But I guess last week, you know, I was giving a talk at St. X, and then I got on my Instagram, and I had a DM from last summer. I had a student from, I think she goes to Sycamore High School. We did some bees at Carachild's Farm, her and her dad. And she messaged me like last week, and she said, hey, I feel like I'm really behind. Like, I'm getting my bees. Like, I got to get the suit. I got to get the bees. I got to go to some classes. And I get that all the time, that everybody's like, you know, Brandon, what do I do? How do I get bees? You know, how do we do this? And in my head, it's like, you got to relax, because, you know, getting bees it's not getting the bees that makes you the beekeeper. It's like being a beekeeper and the actual, like, doing the stuff with bees is actually the smallest part. It's like, if you actually want to be an actual keeper, which is in the name, it's all about how do you set up bees, which is not just honeybees, because they're just one species of thousands, setting up bees for success through their environment, right? And so that takes a long time. You don't even just do that in 1 year. You know, I've been in the game since 2017, and I'm still learning stuff. But this is a book plug. It's not my book, but I'm reading this right now. But I got this book the other day. I know you guys have seen the TED Talk. It's just kind of bright. Let me turn this brightness down. The TED Talk with the guy, Start With Why. He wrote this book, I think last year, called Infinite Game. And he talks about how we all play, we're used to playing like finite games. Like if you're watching the Super Bowl, there's like a winner and a loser. Or if you're playing video games, winner, loser. And when in reality, life is more like, you know, you're playing catch with somebody that you know. You know, you all are playing catch, and then you just play it till you want to stop. But you're doing it for the enjoyment. And at the end, there's no loser. The game can continue to keep going in perpetuity as long as you want. And what I really encouraged her, and she messaged me and said that this is really good for her, was that, you know, you just need to probably read more about bees, learn more about why you want to be a beekeeper. Like, do you want to be a beekeeper because you want to be on, you know, be really hype and popular on social media and because everybody's doing it? Or do you want to be a beekeeper so you can learn more about, you know, how to use all five of your senses to plug into sustainability? It's like, there are different things. You know, it's kind of like if I say I want to have 100 beehives in Cincinnati, well, what happens when I get to 100 beehives? I just have 100 beehives and that's it. Or I could say something and say, hey, I want to increase biodiversity in, throughout the region as much as possible. And there is no end. Like how much biodiversity is enough biodiversity? You know, you just continue to keep going. So her telling me that was inspiring, really. I mean, I'm only on like page 10, so I was riffing off some good stuff, but just creating infinite games for ourselves, I think is really huge. Cause that's what's going to keep you from getting burnt out, because there's always a new adventure every day.
So I know I'm not supposed to say the guy on the call, but yeah, Brandon, to hear that you were inspired by the green store, like, that blows my mind. I'm such a fan of you and what you're doing. So I think that's really cool to hear. And I don't really hear that a lot. So I think that, you know, there have been other stores and zero waste stores that have popped up here locally in Cincinnati. And I do know some of them, the owners came to the green store. So I would hope that they walked away feeling a little bit inspired, but it's not something that you hear often. So I really appreciate you saying that. Yeah, I don't know. It's kind of a one of those things that it's, I don't know if there's a lot of return. You know, there's no awards for, like, I'm sure there is like a best business award, of course, but there isn't a lot of awards. There's not a lot of people clapping for the hard work here in sustainability. So it's not something that you find that often. I do think about my friends and the people close to me, my family, the way that they react and the things that they learn about sustainability just by hearing me talk about it so much, I think is really interesting. I had someone send me like a Instagram story once of someone using a straw at a bar, and someone's like, what if Joy walks in and the person throws the straw across the room? So I think they know, like, I'm anti-straws and, you know, anti-plastic and that sort of thing, and think about how they can adapt some of those behaviors in their own lives. So those little stories and anecdotes are good to hear. Yeah, so maybe I'm waiting, and I'm thinking, like, I'm also a college professor. I've taught maybe over 1,000 students over the last 5 years. I haven't had any of them come to me yet, like, Professor Sears, you changed my life. So maybe that defining moment is in the future, but hopefully
Joy, it's coming. Trust me, it's coming.
Wait, yeah, and that, not to keep, but like, Simone, I would even say you inspire me tonight, because you were talking about how it's important to work with the students, and you got me thinking, you know, I'm not having like a, what is it? When you revisit your life, whatever that moment is called, a reckoning. Now, there's a word for that. Somebody think on that word, but I'm sitting here thinking epiphany. Yes. I'm having like a, right. And I'm sitting here thinking, like, it's really important for the work that you're doing with students, because when I think about, you know, I mean, I've went to great grade schools and everything. First grade school I went to was in the West End. The second I went to was in College Hill. But the connecting piece of that is that every time we had recess, it was on blacktop. Every time we had recess, and I'm like in a good city. I'm in a cool city, right? It's not like I'm in, you know, Cincinnati has space. And so just thinking about how so many students, when you take them out into nature, or when you're doing your, you know, your plant propagation classes, and even the compass stuff. No, it's cool. I got you on the epiphany. But like, when you're doing the class, that might even be for some students their first, like, I didn't even know what kale was until I drank a green smoothie when I was like 23. But for you, they're getting that stuff at, you know, 10.
So this question is kind of for everyone. If you could impart one thing for a takeaway for the people listening, what would it be?
I'll start. Don't be afraid to reinvent yourself.
And for, I think, just to be involved, I think we lose a lot of, especially with COVID, we've lost a lot of community in the sense of like belonging and connection. But there's still ways for you to become involved in like your area. So if you even just go to one of your community council meetings is a way to get involved, or like follow Joy on social media and just follow up and see what she's doing for the next couple months. That's a way for you to get involved and to support people.
Yeah, I guess mine's is just going to be really simple. Spring's happening, I guess, even though it could be 0 degrees in 2 weeks because we're in Cincinnati. But I would say get outside and just walk around. You know, I always tell people the biggest thing is when you go out and you just see the life that's around you, you know, it just opens up your brain. Like, I think that beekeeping for me really changed the whole way I operate, because I always tell people, when was the last time, you know, beekeeping, you got to smell, you got to see, you got to taste, you got to feel, you got to listen. And it's like, when was the last time you used all five of your senses, like legitimately all five, to do anything? You know, a lot of times we're in class in college on PowerPoint or Microsoft Word typing stuff, but you're not interfacing with that. So go outside, literally go outside, especially this spring, because you're going to see all these flowers popping up on trees and stuff. And just go smell something, go feel something, go outside and just experience nature. An hour, and you'll be amazed.
I think for me, there's a quote that I read somewhere, sounds something like, we don't need a handful of people doing sustainability perfectly. We need millions of people doing it imperfectly. And I really think that idea is something to keep in mind, because, you know, there are no perfect people. There's maybe a few people in the world that are predominantly zero waste. I don't know if anyone's completely zero waste, even if they have that mason jar of the small things they've collected over the last year, that's still waste. So no one is at zero, because our world doesn't really allow for that to happen. But we can make those small little bitty changes, and those little changes add up. So if you think about, like, instead of throwing out this single-use plastic because I'm done with it, can I use it for something else? Can I turn it into something else? Laura mentioned a couple statistics that I had in a video that I didn't mention, but one was like, the average American woman wears an item of clothing 6 times before getting rid of it. Because of social media culture, we're quick to wear things, and then when we take a picture once on our Instagram, we don't wear it anymore. Can I wear something in a bunch of different ways? Can I wear something maybe 7 times, 8 times? What are those small, like, everyday little micro changes that you can do and adopt in your life without feeling like completely overwhelmed by what the environment needs of us? So, you know, those small little bitty itty changes and micro evolutions that we can each make in our daily lives. Just keep that in mind, that it adds up.
Awesome. I would love to thank you guys again for giving us your time. Everything that you have talked about really is so inspiring. You know, it leads to, you know, small changes equal big global changes, and starting a movement. And I think it's very important that you guys, I think just hearing the way Brandon talks about you, Joy, and like the way, you know, Sarah talks about Simone, the representation and knowing that, you know, it helps knowing that, you know, nothing's out of bounds, right? Like everything is within reach. And I am so excited that you guys were willing to come talk to us and spend your Saturday night with us. I'm gonna go ahead and open it up and see if anybody else has any more questions. But let's see. Oh, it looks like there's a question for you, Brandon, about milkweed. Is milkweed a good thing to use for pollinators in your yard? Should it be in the ground or potted?
Yeah, we just put in a prairie in Evanston a couple years ago, and the milkweed is all, we just DM'd. But yeah, I think milkweed's great. I'm still learning a lot about it. There's so many different types of milkweed, like swamp milkweed. There's like a tropical milkweed. There's like a butterfly. Like there's so many different plants, but from what I've heard, I know milkweed is what the butterflies need to, you know, complete their maturation process. So it's got to be good.
Can I add to that real fast? So also monarch butterflies specifically, since you're asking, will only put their eggs on milkweed. So milkweed's amazing, but it also is a food for like the tussock moth, which sometimes, it depends on the year, but sometimes has a chance of not being readily available, and could possibly become endangered. So milkweed is an amazing plant, and any of those varieties are great for them. They'll reproduce on any of those.
Looks like we've got a question about what plants are good for a patio or a container garden for pollinators.
So I like to do, I never really plant in containers much, but I've noticed that a lot of people like to plant things that are good for them to eat. Like they like to plant the rosemary. They like to plant, even people like to plant a little lavender. Because then you could use that because it smells good. So just sort of think of, you know, herbs, things that, okay, I'm just looking at the chat. Just think of like different herbs, and, you know, you're not going to put an oak leaf hydrangea in a patio, like in a container, but just look for like little herbs that bees could, you know, thyme. If you've ever seen thyme, creeping thyme, when those little tiny flowers pop up, bees are all over them. So maybe I think for the patio, because, you know, for that, it's such a small area, small space. You don't want anything with super crazy roots, but maybe just think about like small herbs that create this win-win where it's like, okay, I'm feeding you guys, but then also I'm going to put the steak in the oven and I'm going to put some of this thyme on it. You'll probably appreciate the patio. I keep saying patio, container garden, a lot more that way.
I just pulled this off my refrigerator, and don't ask me where I got it. There is a name on the bottom of this, but it's a magnet, and I would love to see somebody recreate this soon. And it's just, you know, the things that you can plant, and it's stuck on my refrigerator. It has to have been there at least 4 years. The date on the bottom says 2013. So I'm sure there's some new information that could help us learn what to plant for not just the bees, but for all pollinators.
Well, it looks like I've been volunteered to help create that. So Sarah, if you'd like one, I can definitely do that. Well, if there aren't any more questions, is there anything else you guys would like to add? Okay. Well, I do want to thank you again for taking your time out of your day to talk to us. And I would like to thank everybody for tuning in. I think this has been such an amazing chat. And I hope that this starts some soul searching and some changes and makes people think about what they can do. If anybody is looking for more information on Joy's Green Store, Brandon's Be the Keeper, or Simone's summer camp, or Sarah's programming, I will send a follow-up email to everybody who registered that has all the info of how to get in touch and how to look up more info.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. It was great to meet you. The chats are rolling in so fast, I can't read them all. Well, it's good to see everybody again. We'll talk to each other again soon.
Joy, when were you at NYU?
Have to share my age.
If I can share mine, I know I don't even want to hear it.
So I think, let me think. I went for grad school. So I started in 2007. So I think I was there probably until 2010.
Okay, I have a niece that was there around that time. That's why okay. I'm asking.
Okay.
Tenuble, last name Tenuble.
Okay. So I went to the Gallatin School of Individualized Study. So it's a school where you can create your own major, pulling from classes from across the university.
Okay. Okay. Cool. Yeah. And Brandon, when would you, no, you said you were at Walnut.
Well,
I went to Walnut.
Mm-hmm. What year did you graduate?
2003.
Okay. I have kids that went through Walnut.
Okay.
Now, Joy, the guy that told me about you like all those years ago was Stanley Wells.
That's
the guy
I was thinking. Okay. Yeah. Stanley, we went to high school together. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes. Yeah, so you were at Walnut. And then did you know my cousin Ashley Bryant as well?
I did. Yeah. Yeah. So
everybody basically says that. Like, I went to St. X, but they're like, you should have went to Walnut. Everybody just loves Walnut.
Yeah.
So, Brandon, here's a little side story. A guy I dated in college went to St. X. And so that's how I ended up here in Cincinnati.
Are you serious? No way. Hey, that's how you did that. I mean,
he used to talk about St. X, and he used to talk about Cincinnati, and I came to visit, and I had some options to work at GE, and I picked Cincinnati because of the stories that he told me.
That's crazy. I know. Well, Sarah, where'd you go to school?
I went to Macaulay.
I grew up. You talk about story time, Simone. I grew up 3 doors down from Macaulay on Connecticut Avenue.
Oh, wow.
Oh my gosh,
so, you know, I'm like literally, and then like right when I got into St. X, we moved to Bond Hill, and I like literally was Gregory Street. And I was always like, you go to an all guys school, you know, I'm supposed to like, I didn't really, you know, it's kind of like, wouldn't you want to be like, stay close? You know, to McCollum? But yeah, St. X is it's a cool place. I think, and then Walnut Hills, I think that they're doing a lot of sustainability stuff too.
Yeah. That whole piece, I forget what it's called, Walnut Woods or something, right next to the school, mm-hmm. where they're pulling out all of the bad stuff and trying to make it a livable space, a usable space. Mm-hmm. And I want to say some kids, and it might have been from, you mentioned, what was the program that you talked about? The carriage, The Carriage Farm. Yeah. I want to say that they were involved with some things to help New Prospect look at some sustainability stuff a couple years ago.
Yeah, probably. They're all over. And then I think
they had high school students that came out and took measurements and helped design a plan.
Yeah. So. Well, and then, Joy, would you say in Europe, the high school, well, I guess you were in Europe for like 3 years, right? At one point?
Yeah.
Are the high schoolers, like, because Simone, you would say in Cincinnati, it's like kind of an upswing, but it seems like Europe is, I mean, I don't know. I've only been in Europe for a month, but are they further ahead with their youth than us?
It depends.
Yeah, I think overall they are. I don't know about sustainability specifically, but in sustainability wise, they're ahead of us. So I would assume that they would be. They would do more in schools. I've actually been looking a lot at the Green School. Have you all heard? Are you familiar with the Green School? They are. It's like a. There's green schools in Bali. In Tulum, Mexico, New Zealand, South Africa, and I think maybe one or two more, but it's really like a sustainability, like immersive preschool through high school. So when I think about where I want my kids to go to school, I'm obsessed with the green school because when like Brandon, you mentioned going outside and to the blacktop for recess, like it's there. Their whole school's outside, they're playing with the bugs, they're in the mud, they're learning about pollinators like from like the age of two or three. So I hope to see more of that in the future, like internationally, more of those sort of schools popping up.
Well, and I even heard for like newborns, I guess Simone and Joy, you guys know about this. Sarah, I think we're still not parents, right? apparently like it helps kids' immune systems to touch like the soil and get out. And I mean, maybe, I don't know, you know, maybe not too, like not super early, but I heard that when kids are out walking around and digging and stuff, like sure, they always say get dirt in your nails and everything, yeah. But apparently it gets your gut biome and all of that, you're breathing in things.
Yeah. You know, that's what the whole natural habitat and the exposure of bees and bee honey. For kids with allergies, local honey is like one of the best things. So if you take that concept and expand it, it makes sense to me.
Mm-hmm. And Brandon, sure. You got an award recently, didn't you? You won the Sustainability Accelerator, or what was it?
Oh, the flywheel. Yeah, that was yeah. Big because I got denied to every other accelerator I applied to for like the past 4 years. So then I get into that one. And then we took home first place, but it was like, I'm really glad that I didn't get any of the other accelerators. Cause like this one was the one for me. Like, honestly, like everybody, you know, like my girlfriend, we've been dating for so many years now, you know, she does a lot of fashion and stuff. So she was in New York and Florence and California doing businessy stuff. And every time I talk to people when we're like traveling, they're like, oh man, like you got to go to Portland or like you got to go to Seattle because they're like really green there. Mm-hmm. But then like Cincinnati, like Simone, I know you, we know a lot of people like, you know, Joy, like, I mean, you know, it's just like the closeness of everything in Cincinnati, like, you know, like I did a walkthrough with a client today and she's told me that her husband, her father, her grandfather, and her son all went to St. X. And I would never be able to have, so I mean, not trying to plug it, but you know, but like all these people, to think that the guy that created a program at UC that I did as a high schooler that got me into college is a guy that called me, that was in 2009, the same guy that called me in 2017 or 18, whenever the Globe Theater thing was happening, I think he did a few different pop-ups, to go to Joy's thing. You can't tell me that's going to happen in some big city, you know, like, so I don't even, I mean, even Sarah called me last week. I don't even think that we were, I mean, maybe it was 2 weeks ago, but I don't even think we were on this panel thing yet. And you're like, hey, you want to go do this green thing later in the year. So I just think that Cincinnati, I'm not leaving. I'm not leaving.
So I think it's neat, Joy, that you've been working with the Urban Bloom Group. Mm-hmm. They were at Walnut with my son. What's his name? But I'm excited about that whole concept. And here's what I'll put out there that's been on my head. How do we package that in a dorm room? I want one for my daughter's dorm room next year.
I know they sell the little walls. I know at least around the holidays, they have the little walls, like picture frame size.
That you can that's big enough for a dorm room, right? Mm-hmm. So just that concept. And we're going to do something this summer, Joy and Brandon. I'm not sure what, but it's so interesting that I haven't really done a whole lot with the pollinators piece. But one of the things that I pulled out is about creating hand pollinators. So it's a science piece, but certainly we can put pollinators, make sure we have that conversation and add that to what we do, right? And zero waste. My daughter flipped out this afternoon because she didn't have her straw with her when we went into the restaurant. So she's getting it. And then I need, Joy, I know you have the little portable culinary sets, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'll be going onto your site and ordering that very soon because she lost hers.
Okay.
And it's freaking her out.
I love to hear that.
Yeah, she's like, oh my God, I left my straw. I was like, you got that purse. Why isn't it in your purse? Well, it was, but I took it out and I was cleaning it. And so, yeah. She didn't want to eat, drink. She didn't want to use the paper straw.
Okay.
and even Joy, like I was thinking, because I think I just found out that there's somebody doing zero waste stuff in Madisonville. And then I got a friend, Rachel, who's down on Vine Street. Mm-hmm. And then there's you.
And Rachel came to the store, yeah.
And Rachel definitely came to the store. I met her at a Green Umbrella event a couple years ago.
So Joy, the first person that introduced me to zero waste looked like us.
Okay.
A close girlfriend of mine. And I was like, what are you talking about? What? Yeah, so that was probably about 10 years ago, Joy.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, I've not come a long way, but I'm moving. I'm inching in the right direction. Like I said, my daughter and her straw thing.
Yeah, I'm a long way. I'm a long way.
Hey, but if everybody goes a little short way, everybody goes a short way, it's like, boom.
Every That's day right. I'm trying to be better. It's hard.
Mm-hmm. No, it's not. When you talked about the clothes and what, you know, the average number of times you wear them and, you know, thinking about things differently, that's all it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Taking a bit more time, slowing down, which is what I think this time is beneficial for. Like you have just a little bit more time to make slower decisions and slowing things down a little bit.
Well, my family's bugging me. We have a 6 o'clock call every evening from wherever we are in the world. So I'm way off my time to get on that. So it's been a pleasure and I will be in touch with you guys.
Yeah.
All right. Bye-bye.
I'll see you guys.
Okay. Bye.
All right. Bye. Wait, I got to find the button. all right. Oh, leave. All right. I'll see y'all.
Bye, guys. Thank you so much.
See you, Laura.
Bye, Brandon. Sarah, you were awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks. I'm leaving. I'm trying to leave.